Hello everyone, it's Jess Hartz, and after a week, a gallon of tea, and a heap of research that turns out to be over 400 photos, 8 blueprint and planning out drawings, I have recreated the Edith Finch house in 14 hours. I kid you not, 14 hours and 50 minutes. Also, exciting news, a journalist, Joanna, contacted me from PC Gamer after she saw my photo of the Edith Finch house on Twitter. And if you don't know what PC Gamer is, it's a huge gaming magazine that's been around since the early 90s, and she wanted to do a piece on my build. So I'll be linking that article in the description when she publishes it. But how cool is that? I was so flattered. I can't get over it. It's just really cool. And I also read a lot of PC Gamer articles, so it was just like, oh damn, I'm gonna have my own one. But yeah, like I said, I did so much stuff for this build, and that's not even including all the stuff I did behind the scenes. I didn't include the decorations of a certain room in the house, but you will be able to see it at the end. And I will also be giving you a guided tour throughout the house, because honestly, screenshots would just not do this house justice, and it would take forever to compile all the screenshots. There's just too many little details in this house. But yes, firstly, I'd like to preface lots of spoilers, all the spoilers. This video is absolutely spoiled. If you haven't played Edith Finch, go buy this game. Not sponsored, I wish though, or go watch somebody's gameplay of it. And if you played What Remains, hey, how you doing? Still crying over Walter? Because I am. Now, I've played this game a lot of times now, prepping for this house and this video. If I miss anything though, or if you have your own opinions, feel free to leave them below. But without further ado, let's get into What Remains of Edith Finch. What Remains of Edith Finch is a story game. You cannot change what happens in the game, nor the outcome, but you can definitely miss some vital information along the way. You move around as the main character, Edith, and you unlock the stories of her late family. But within that story, we see the stories of her family and the glimpses of what happened to them, how they all died. Every time we find out how somebody in the family dies, Edith draws them into the family tree in her journal, with their birth and death times. It's cute, but very morbid when you see it. Only 9 of the entries to the family tree you actually delve into. The way you play this game probably isn't for everyone. It's like an interactive movie / book. All you can really do is move around and interact with certain things. Then Edith will speak, or a sequence will play. A source for this video said that this game is like one of those childhood pop-up books that you pull the tabs that move things around the page. You know, those kind of books. And I think that's a beautiful analogy for this story. I will also touch on that later again in the video. We start out on a boat, no knowledge of what's happening and who we are. In our right hand, an arm that has a cast on it, we hold some calla lilies, I believe that's how they're said. Something I haven't heard anyone actually touch on is what these types of flowers represent. Some of you may know, but I am a lover of flowers. These flowers, along with sunflowers, are probably two of my favorites. This specific flower can represent fertility, life, and more well-known, death. And that's definitely something worth remembering as we venture further into this story. We opened the book to see a page with 3 entries. 2 of them have already been scribbled out, saying, "My family never seemed strange to me when I was growing up." But then we turn the page and here comes a beautiful artistry and subtitles. They are used to guide you, express intent and emotion, and to, of course, tell the story. This happens all throughout the game, but something I tend to forget is that you're actually reading about Edith's journey in that book on the boat. We go in a few layers deep, which can be confusing, but when we dive into that book, we start as Edith with a key that she inherited from her late mother, Dawn, and the most recent victim of the Finch family curse. She wanders down a slope towards her old house and just looks crazy, overwhelming and intriguing all at once. You can go 2 directions, one that a car would have driven down and the other where a path has been made through a forest. In this forest, we find old newspapers with the missing Milton on the cover. This was Edith's brother. She comes towards the house and finds she can't open the front door, so she makes her way through the doggy door in the side of the garage. We also get a glimpse of a broken swing over the fence. You're met with a musty, cluttered interior, probably more like most people's garages. The power is still off, so a lot of the rooms are only lit by sunlight. We move our way through the cluttered and lived-in house. It's honestly one of the best game homes I've ever seen. It genuinely looks like this belonged to a large family. I can only imagine how many hours it took planning this whole design. Edith talks about how her mum had boarded up a lot of the rooms, including a library. We can only see glimpses of it through a peephole. Great-grandmother Edie had installed a lot of peepholes in a lot of the doors as protest. As we make our way to the second floor, we see books, lots of books, plus a broken railing that had been semi-fixed. Something to remember. We walk around this landing and see various bedrooms that have been boarded up, but with peepholes. There is also another staircase going up to the third level, but it has been locked up by Edith's mother. We then make our way into the first bedroom, a room where the door is still ajar. This room belonged to Walter, Edith's great uncle. This room is bare, only with a mural of a decrepit house, a couple sharks, and an old sign buried in the sand saying Finches. This all takes place under the sea in this mural. Kind of an interesting thing to paint on a child's bedroom, but I think it'll make sense in the end. We come across our first passageway in the wall, and on this wall there is a mural of the train, and in the window there is an upright book with a padlock holding it shut. Edith hasn't been through any of these passageways, which I should add, but her older brothers definitely had. Milton, the missing brother, had painted a cat in the secret passageway, and her other brother, Lewis, had mentioned these passageways before, but Edith didn't believe him. When we make our way through the passageway, we come to Molly's room, Walter's sister, the first child of Edie Finch, and I love her bedroom. She seemed like an inquisitive little girl. On her desk there is a starfish that she had been dissecting. She also has a gerbil cage, branches hanging from the ceiling, and we see a painting of Molly wearing cat ears on a piece of wood, memorialized by her mother Edie. And right behind it, we see where Molly had drawn on a chalkboard a sea monster coming from a castle to attack a boat. We then come across Molly's journal where it reads, December 13th, 1947. I'll be gone soon, but I wanted to tell somebody about what's going to happen. Then we delve into a layer deeper into the story for the first time. We become Molly in her room at night, and she's starving. Her mother has locked her in her room without supper, presumably she was playing up. We play as her looking for something to eat. We think about eating a goldfish, but that doesn't end up happening. We ask Edie if we can come out to eat by trying to open the door, but Edie refuses. We eat a carrot that's stale from the gerbil's cage, a tube of toothpaste from our bathroom, and some holly berries above her toilet, which can cause vomiting among other bad side effects. Then we wander over to her window where we spot a barn swallow, a mama bird, and us, the audience, start thinking, oh heck, this is how Molly dies. She falls out the window trying to catch the bird. Nope. She turns into a cat and starts chasing the bird through the treetops. She spots her mother and her father, Sven, through a window, but they take no notice. After some kiddie parkour, we end up catching the mama bird, and suddenly, mid-air, we turn into an owl. And of course, she's still hungry. We play as the owl swooping down onto rabbits and eating. Very disturbing visuals, I might add. But here comes a kind of derpy moment, IMO. When she starts choking on one more rabbit, she turns into a shark. And we kind of play as this like ragdolled shark falling down a cliff. Probably not its best moment, this game. But then, into the sea we go. We catch some seals, but once again, she's still hungry. We jump out of the water and onto a fishing boat, where we start sliding around as a giant tentacle. I'm presuming there's like a big sea monster at the end of that tentacle. We end up eating the crew, and then the tone gets even more morbid when we start sliding as a sea creature through the pipes and up into Molly's toilet. Then we hide under her bed. Flash. She wakes up back in her bed and hurriedly starts writing it all down. She knows she's about to be eaten by the sea monster. And we leave this story and back to Edith in the room. From what I can kind of dissect from that is that maybe she ate all those things and had one heck of a fever dream and then died from the poisoning she got. I'm no botanist, but I know holly is poisonous. But I don't think 2 to 3 would kill a 10-year-old girl. But I digress. Edith then draws Molly's picture into a book and makes her way out the same window and walks along the crotch-hatched overhang towards Edie's bedroom window. What we come across here disturbs me a lot personally. We find her late husband's memorialized corner with his photo, his hard hat, and a newspaper cover reading, "Dragon Kills Finch." Edie would always say that a dragon killed her husband, but in reality, he was building a dragon-shaped slide next to the house. Edie loved to embellish. We walk around the bedroom and find another shelf where Edie's father, Odin, had been memorialized. Bear in mind, all of these places have pieces of wood with portraits on them of the people who have died. Edie paints them. Edith picks up the stereoscope, kind of like a pair of binoculars that flicks through photos, and we see a picture of a house that looks a lot like the one painted on Walter's bedroom wall. It reads, "For 500 years, the Finches have been famous throughout Norway for their fortune and misfortune." Pretty much the slides depict how Odin's wife and newborn son had just died due to the family curse. Odin then flees Norway in 1937 with the house tugged by boat, hoping to leave the curse behind. But Odin ends up dying on the travels, and the house is left sunk off the shore of the newly built Finch House. But before this could even be built, Edie and Sven bury Odin. Odin Finch is the first to be buried in the new family cemetery. And off in the distance, we can see the scaffolding of the new home being built. I've seen a few people take issue with this, even Edith herself, that they built the monument to Odin before even building the house. I won't lie, it's pretty commonplace to bury or mourn the dead before making a new beginning. Maybe the whole family cemetery thing sets off a few red flags, but I'm not so sure. But at the same point with the full narrative behind this, it can be seen a little bit morbid. Mind you, Edie had full intent on making it as grandiose as possible. You can also see the house just above the water from Edie's bedroom, a constant reminder of her past. As we move around the room, we come across another piece of wood Edie had started painting on. It was a portrait of Edith's older brother, Lewis. He died a week before Edith and her mother left. Edie had already started to memorialize him. Around Edie's bedroom, we see an oxygen tank next to her bed, a pill container, and hanging by the window are a few bird cages. Well, a lot of bird cages, all with their respecting photographs, memorializing all those birds. I think Edie just thought the curse went further than just humans. There is also a newspaper clipping about a mole man beneath the Finch House that Edie had framed and also had an interview about. Edith's mother was apparently furious. There was also another newspaper clipping where they were told to evacuate Orcas Island, where they live, but Edie refused to leave. We then venture into the bathroom off Edie's bedroom, and holy moly, it's pink. This was due to the decorating of Sam's ex-wife, Kay. Sam was Edith's grandfather. This room doesn't really hold much aside from the fact it's obnoxiously pink, and who the heck puts pink shag rug in their bathroom? I protested so much, I believe I even put pink tiles in there instead. I didn't want to put pink shag rug in there. Anyway, we come to another padlock book above the toilet. The cover reads, "There's a Secret in This Bathroom" by Sven and Edie. As we open the book, it's revealed to be a pop-up pull tab book. We see Sven, Sam, and his brother Calvin as characters in the book inside the bathroom. As we mess around with the tabs, it's revealed that the secret is actually hidden in the book. If we pull a little tab, a piece of paper flips up and a twisty knob appears, and when it's twisted, a secret door falls open above the toilet to another secret passageway. In the secret passageway to Sam and Calvin's room, we see where Sven had what appears to be a photo developing room. It's said that Sven gave his son Sam an old camera he had refurbished, and Sam never sat it down. As we crawl down the passageway, we come from underneath Sam's desk in Sam and Calvin's childhood bedroom. This room makes me personally really, really sad and a little jealous of what they got, of how they got such a sick bedroom. Half of the room is military themed for Sam, and the other half is space astronaut themed for Calvin. Edith exclaims how she knew her grandpa, Sam, had a twin, and that he never spoke about him, and that she believes he didn't like history just as much as her mother did. As we cross a miniature bridge over Calvin's bed, we come across the command center where his space helmet sat alongside another piece of wood with his portrait painted on it. When we pop the visor open, we find a note written by her grandpa, Sam, and it reads, "How I Want to Remember My Brother" by Sam Finch. We delve once again into the past as Calvin on the swing set we saw broken at the beginning. This swing set overlooks the cliff, and like, I'm not a parent, but that raises a lot of red flags for me. Not a safe swing spot, just saying. But we begin to swing up and down as Calvin, and he's trying to go right around the swing, full circle, and I'm pretty sure we all tried that as a kid. Heck, I even remember the TV show Recess, where a main character's arc was that she wanted to go all the way around. Anyway, we see that Calvin has a cast on his ankle, which again leads me to believe a lot of these kids were pretty reckless. As Sam narrates the scene by saying, "My brother said he'd die before he ate another mushroom." And he did. Then on to say, "At Barbara's funeral, we swore we'd never be afraid again." And he wasn't. As Calvin gets higher and higher, the tone gets more and more intense. And Sam ends up saying, "The day he made up his mind to fly." And he did. And as Sam says this, Calvin goes full circle, but the wind picks up, and you can tell by the way his legs are contorting, he's scared and he's trying to defend himself from the branches. He ends up letting go and soars off the cliff. This part made me tear up, especially the first time, and especially knowing that Calvin always wanted to fly. The music simmers down, and Edith draws Calvin's picture in her book and exclaims, "Calvin's story felt strangely familiar. I remember trying to do the exact same thing." This bothers me a lot, personally. Why wouldn't they have taken down the swing set? It was such a hazard. Where were the adults, man? After Calvin's funeral, Edie roped off his part of the room. It almost looks like something you'd see at a museum, to be honest. Sam never set foot in the room again after he enlisted at 18. But after this room, we crawl underneath the command center, and there is a small bookcase. An intricate lock has been made out of books. When you open the book, it shows a handle, where when you pull up, another secret passageway appears. Sven was a big fan of these, apparently. As you crawl down the passageway, you find that it's actually inside a wine cabinet that sits behind the main staircase. But as you venture further, you climb out of a trunk inside Barbara's room. Barbara is the most famous of the Finches. She was a child horror scream queen. She was 16 when she died. When we go around her room, it shows all of her awards, a life-size cutout of her as a child with a Bigfoot character behind her, but as she's gotten older, it appears her acting career didn't follow her. We come across another piece of wood with a portrait painted on it, alongside a film reel and a dreadful stories comic book. Edith says, as she's grabbing the comic book, "Of all the stories people wrote about Barbara's death, I'm surprised Edie saved this one." As we open the comic, a jack-o'-lantern named Old Jack starts to narrate. Might I add, this comic is in very poor taste, especially about a 16-year-old's death. This step down the rabbit hole is played out in small sequences, as if you were actually reading a comic book. It's really cool, to be honest. It reveals that Barbara was famous for her scream as a child, but that she is now washed up and cannot land an acting job. But she'd been asked to perform her signature scream at the BeastieCon 1960, so it shows her and her boyfriend practicing. Due to her scream being pretty terrible now at 16, her current boyfriend Rick goes to demonstrate when a loud scream rings out. Sven, her father, had an accident, so Edie and him left for the hospital. Barbara was stuck babysitting her younger brother Walter and couldn't attend the BeastieCon. She was frustrated, the radio starts blaring out about Halloween masked hoodlums terrorizing Orcas Island, when a loud crash can be heard from the basement. The boyfriend Rick goes to investigate, but Barbara has to show him how to open the basement door. Sven had made a secret system to finding the key. The music box key had to be winded and winded until it pulled out. Then only could you unlock the basement door with that key. Might I add, it's interesting that this comic book author found this out. Who do you think would have told him this very specific secret detail? Somebody who likes embellishing, maybe? Rick left for the basement, and after some time, Barbara goes to look for him. This is when we start to play as Barbara. We pull the key out and make our way down the staircase, and I don't believe anyone else has brought this up, but the Michael Myers or Halloween theme music starts to play, which, if you don't know, is an old slasher horror movie, which is super fitting since the main character in those movies is also a scream queen. Anyway, I digress. Barbara finds Rick's crutch at the end of the staircase, and then she wields it like a weapon. She then finds the fridge at the end of the basement. It's moving around, making a ruckus, and then it's her boyfriend in a mask. She whacks him with his crutch in the face. Good on her. He tries to explain that he was just trying to help her find her scream, but she's furious, so she kicks him out and keeps his crutch. She ends up falling asleep on the couch, but is awoken by her little brother Walter calling out for help. She grabs a crutch, makes her way to his bedroom, but he's nowhere to be found. Only a radio is shown on his bed. Then suddenly it blurts out something different this time. There's a 6-foot-tall man with a hook for a hand on the loose, and how many times have we heard that story? And the police urge residents to keep safe and lock up. But then we see an orange jumpsuited man with a hook for a hand walk up behind Barb. She sees him, lets out a gasp. They struggle for a bit, but she kicks him in the nuts and crawls through the secret passageway between Walter and Molly's room. Once again, how could the author know anything about this without being tipped off? Barbara sneaks up behind the man and whacks him with a crutch, and he slips on her roller skates, only to break through the second floor landing's railing and smashes into the glass coffee table below. She goes down to investigate, but he's no longer there. The doorbell rings and she goes to open the door when she hears some whispering, only to discover it's inside the house. She is met with a huge surprise from a group of what looked like at first Halloween costume people, and that they all had come to surprise her. She was elated, but then she realizes they are actually all real monsters. They're to murder her, I guess? Then the narrator says she realized she was going to be famous, and with her final breath, Barbara French gave the performance of her life. She screamed, they killed her, poor taste, the end. Okay, so the police blamed it all on her boyfriend, who did disappear. Poor Walter was under his bed the whole time, bloody traumatized, and the narrator says he took it pretty hard, but that's another story, which in my mind glances forward at the Mole Man newspaper clipping. Unfortunately, all that was left of Barbara was her ear. It was tucked inside the music box, in the comic version of her death anyway. Edith then draws Barbara inside her book. Okay, so what I really think happened is a bit more saddening. It's mentioned at the beginning of the comic that Rick was Barbara's biggest fan of all, and her current boyfriend. And to me, he seemed a bit of a jerkhole, especially the whole hiding in the basement thing. I think after Barbara kicked out Rick, he must have gotten really mad, came back, a fight ensued, maybe Rick fell through the railing or Barbara did accidentally, and the glass from the coffee table cut off her ear. I don't know. And then Rick placed it in the music box? Well, in the comic version at least, and made off with her body whilst poor darling Walter witnessed parts of it and became traumatized. Something I noticed was the fact that when Rick jumped out of the fridge, masked, he wasn't using either of his crutches. He had somehow jumped out of the fridge on both legs and not hurt himself or had fallen over. Maybe it was a cover-up from a deranged fan, or maybe a continuity error. I'm not sure, just something I did notice. Anyway, we move back to Edith and we go down to the basement, using the same music box key trick as in the comic, so we know it's true. We come to the basement and you can see this is where Sven spent most of his time crafting and building. A miniature model of the dragon-shaped slide is on his workbench, and off to the left are pre-made pieces of wood, like the ones Edie had been painting on to memorialize the dead. They were being mass-produced, which is so morbid. I think Sven believed in the curse just as much as Edie did. But then we move towards the refrigerator, the same from the story. Edith says she had seen Edie sneaking down to the basement once with packages. She thought she was hiding presents. But when we open the fridge and a generated power light switches on, she says, it turns out she was hiding a lot more than that. An underground secret passageway crawls down and down. Edith says how she asked her mum Dawn where Walter had gone, and she said after Barbara died, he got as far away as he could. We come to a room filled with preserves, cereal, peanut butter, bags. It's a doomsday bunker. And Edith says something common about all their stories is that none of them have gotten very far. We find Walter's bunker. In the small bunker, we can see that they had moved Walter's bunk bed down here, and he has a pretty cozy setup. Once again, Edie has memorialized him with a portrait, some candles, his canned peaches, and the last thing he wrote. And it reads, "Goodbye, everyone. I can't believe I've been down here for 30 years. He states how he didn't think he'd survive a week when it started shaking. We then delve into Walter's story and start playing as him. The year is 1968. Rock music is playing, and as the clock strikes 12, it starts shaking. The bunker starts shaking. He looks around to find out what's happening, but then proceeds to open his canned peaches. He says after a few days, it became routine, and it kept him sane, which is a common thing for people who suffer from trauma do. They love routine. It's safe. He opens his peaches and gulps them down. A flash forward in time and it's 1976. The shaking starts again as it strikes 12 and he says, even a monster on the other side of the door starts to feel normal, almost friendly. What he says there has always reminded me of some lyrics from a Nirvana song. I miss the comfort in being sad. I think these are one and the same if a bit different. If we become used to something enough, no matter how terrible, we adapt and it becomes routine. We are comfortable in the normalcy of it. But then he opens his peaches and gulps them down too. A flash forward in time again, and it's 2005. And then once again, looking at the can of peaches, waiting for the clock to strike 12, he says, and then one day, everything just stopped. No more shaking to be seen. His routine had been messed with. He states, whatever that thing was, it was gone. Maybe it got tired of waiting, or maybe I just got tired of being afraid. But he proceeds to eat his peaches. A week passes and still no shaking, no rattling at all. He says it's been the longest week in 30 years for him. He gets up from his chair and moves towards a trap door in the ground. He says in this quietly powerful way that he's done waiting and that he has to leave while he still can. He climbs down a ladder to where it seems he had been keeping all his rubbish and more preserves. And as he walks into the opening, he says he knows it's out there somewhere. Whatever killed Barbara and Molly and Calvin. He then picks up a sledgehammer and starts breaking down a brick wall. Something I touched on earlier was how beautiful the subtitles are in this game. Every time he speaks, the subtitles appear and slam into the wall every time the hammer hits. It makes what he's saying even more powerful and profound, as if they were the only force breaking down the wall, not just the hammer. What he says during this is, maybe this is all a mistake, but I need to stop living the same day, even if it kills me. It opens up to a tunnel and some train tracks. There is a lovely warm light coming from the entrance, which is such a contrast to the dark and sad bunker. As we walk down the tunnel, the music picks up and he begins to say, whatever's out there, I want you to know I'm ready for it. I'm going to appreciate all of it, especially the food. I don't mind if I only have a year left, or a month, or a single week. I'd be happy with one new day. And as he reached the exit to the tunnel and looks up at the sky, we hear a train honking its horn. And he finishes with saying, I can already imagine the sun on my face. A bright light fills up the whole screen and we fade back to Edith. That part genuinely made me tear up. It is such a sad moment. What confuses me, though, is that Walter loves trains. He had the giant mural of a train in his bedroom wall. He was even building a model train in his bunker. Did he just akin the train passing his bunker and rattling everything to the monster that was the house? The curse? Or was it a nuisance? He doesn't seem to actually be scared of the rattling. He's more so scared of whatever killed his siblings. Either way, he believed in this thing, this entity so much as a child and into adulthood, that he locked himself away for 30 years. His mother and father let him lock himself away at the fear of this thing. Not to mention Edie making a mockery of her own son by doing an interview about there being a mole man under the house. She let her son decay down there in fear, alone. She didn't help him, and she didn't try to get him to a doctor. Oh man, this part makes me furious. Edith goes on to say that Walter died when she was only 6, and her mother Dawn never told her. She thinks her mother was trying to protect her and that maybe she was afraid Edith would end up like Walter. Edith continues to say, but if she never told me about my Uncle Walter under the house, I can only imagine what else she was hiding. I don't want to make the same mistake she made, trying to bury something that's still alive. As Edith is saying this, she makes her way through the trapdoor and onto the train track, the same way Walter went. She says now that there's only one of us left, or maybe two, hint, hint, one major hint that she's pregnant throughout this journey is that you can actually look down at yourself or Edith and see you got a belly bump. But then she proceeds to say how she thought it was time she heard the stories for herself. She proceeds to say how she thought it was time she heard the stories for herself and find out what happened to everyone. She goes on to say something poignant. But now I'm worried the stories themselves might be the problem. Maybe we believe so much in the family curse, we made it real. As Hermione once said, fear of the name increases fear of the thing itself. Or how many times have we been told if you keep calling yourself stupid, you will become stupid. Or if you keep pulling that face, it'll get stuck like that. If we put enough belief into something, it becomes real. Like telling yourself a lie for so long that you can't even remember what really happened. For a long, long time, I thought we left my childhood home because there was a monster snake chasing us out. I vividly remember my dad carrying me to the car and a snake slithering around his feet. Only when I really sat back and looked at the memory when I got older, I realized how ridiculous it was. But that whole time, I was believing a nightmare I had as a kid to be true, because I didn't put a whole lot of thought into it, just unsubjective belief, and that made it real. And I believe that's exactly what happened to the Finches, a self-fulfilling prophecy, not to mention atrocious parenting. But anyway, at the end of the tunnel, we find another memorial for Walter. A little toy train set is placed on a shelf on top of a post, plus a conductor's hat. As we move further down the train track, see that it is now dismantled and in ruins. The old house is peeping out from the water, and some deck chairs are stuck in the trees. We follow the path and see even more chairs, but we come to a beach, as Edith continues to ponder whether or not she should even be writing this, and that maybe it would be better if the stories died with her. She goes to walk onto the sand and say, "But I thought you should know about your family and the history you're a part of. Though, to be honest, I feel as lost as you probably do by now." We then start climbing the steps towards the house, and Edith goes on to talk about how the people in these stories probably believed them, for what that's worth. And as she reaches the top, she says that when you look at the house, at the history of imagination and stubbornness and madness, any of it seems possible. There is something to say for the Finches. They are all those things and more. Their personalities are so ambitious without boundaries. Even Edith's mother, Dawn, who seems rather tame in comparison to her family members, went overseas to help. Was it possible that this family was just that hell-bent on ambition in life that they lost their lives along the way? Whether it be from reckless behavior, carelessness on a parent's part, an accident, and people just blamed it all on the curse? Well, the story doesn't end there, and I think we will touch back on that question. Well, hello everyone. Sorry to interrupt the seriousness. Hey, take this time to have a breather. Relax. I know a lot of people voted for a giant video, but altogether it'd be over an hour, possibly an hour and a half, so I thought I'd chop this bad boy up, because otherwise you guys would go without another video for a week. But right after this, I will be recording me touring the house, and the second half should be up in only a few days. I don't want to completely drain you guys and myself all at once. Also, I hope you don't mind the lack of crazy editing. I thought we'd go old school for this one. Also, we are only 10 away from 800 subs, so thank you guys so, so much. That means the world to me. But yeah, I gotta go. So I hope you've enjoyed the first half of the Edith Finch build. Make sure you're subscribed because it makes my self-worth go up tenfold, and you'll be notified when part two goes up. It's a win-win. Have a great day or night, guys. Bye!